So let me start with my teenage years growing up in New York City. Somewhere in high school, I got fascinated with chemistry and physics. And when I told my father about this, he reminded me that he had come to the U.S. from Russia originally, actually from Georgia, to study chemical engineering at MIT. This was in 1920. And he left in early 1923 when his father's money to support him ran out because of the Russian Revolution. But he had learned enough about chemical engineering there to tell me about its virtues and why this was a good discipline to study, and actually caused me to start thinking about chemical engineering as a discipline instead of going to chemistry or into pure science. And so when I got to be at an age of deciding to go to college, I made the decision to go into chemical engineering instead of chemistry. And actually, the year before that, I had spent Saturdays at the Columbia University in a program for high school students there. So I went to MIT, studied chemical engineering for 4 years there, became fascinated with it, took a minor in physics. Let's interrupt for a second so I can tell. Tatiana? Okay, so I went to MIT as an undergraduate and started studying chemical engineering. I fell in love with the subject. I also took a minor in physics. And for a while in my junior, senior year, I toyed with going into physics, leaving chemical engineering and going into physics for a PhD. But then I decided that my mathematical skills weren't quite as sharp as they'd need to be a good physicist. So I stayed with chemical engineering. In my senior year, I did a project for a senior thesis with a man named Ray Badur, a member of the faculty there, and in the area of plasma chemistry. Using microwaves to produce hydrogen atoms from molecular hydrogen. And that got me interested in both plasma physics, plasma chemistry, and chemical reaction engineering in general. And so that satisfied my interests in physics as well as chemistry and chemical engineering. And then I decided that it would be fun to continue that work, so I applied to the PhD program at MIT, was accepted, and then for the next 3 years continue working with Ray Badur in this area of plasma chemistry. So this had nothing to do with catalysis, except for the fact that Badur also had a parallel program going on in catalysis on the same floor in the same laboratory. So I rubbed shoulders with people like Jim Katzer, who was my contemporary, and learned a little bit about catalysis by the fact that we had desks next to each other in the same office. So near the end of my period at MIT, one of the fellow students in the group there, Bill Koch of the Koch brothers from Wichita, Kansas, came to me and he said, "Hey, Alex, you know, you read Russian. Could you translate these three articles from the Ukrainian Journal of Chemistry?" And they turned out to be articles by Tyranian and co-workers on the use of infrared spectroscopy to look at ethylene epoxidation in situ. So I did the translations for him, learned a little bit about infrared spectroscopy and adsorbed species in the process of reading these papers. Thought nothing about it, and left in the late summer of 1967 to come here to Berkeley. So once here at Berkeley, I started a program in plasma chemistry, picked up several graduate students to do this kind of work, and about 2 years into my assistant professorship, Gene Peterson, a colleague of mine at the time here, came and said, "Hey Alex, we have an EPA grant which is ending in a year, and we have $15,000 left. You can have it if you like it, because the guy who had it before just left the university. But you have to do something in the area of catalysis. So I thought about it for a moment. You don't give away $15,000. And I then said, well, my God, what do I know about catalysis? Which was absolutely nothing, never having studied it, never having done research in the area. So I went back to these three papers that I had translated and decided to make a project out of that. And with the $15,000, we bought an infrared spectrometer and some other equipment to build a microreactor, designed a in-situ cell, and took off. And by 1972, I think it was, the first papers came out on our work on infrared spectroscopy applied to ethylene epoxidation. And it's to my amusement and satisfaction that Mark Bartow continues to cite these papers today, some 36 years later. So basically, what I'm trying to say is I got into catalysis by chance, by fortune of knowing Russian language, the fact that my father had studied chemical engineering, so it all brought me to this point. And having gotten there, I decided that I'll run two programs, one in catalysis and one in plasma chemistry, just like my research director had at MIT. And I did this until about 1980, when it became too hard to continue funding two very different kinds of programs, and the money for plasma chemistry was much harder to get than the money for catalysis. This was the shortly after the period where the U.S. government had formed IRDA, which then became DOE, out of the old AEC. I was able to get substantial amounts of money, along with Gabor and Samarjai and other members of our faculty, for the area of catalysis. So in that period, I got started on doing Fischer-Tropsch synthesis, also coal gasification, coal liquefaction. So those are my early days in the field of catalysis. I then went on to look at the application of all sorts of forms of spectroscopy in situ, starting with infrared, later going into Raman, picking up NMR along the way together with Jeff Reimer, my colleague here, looking at UV visible, later with Enrique Iglesia, another colleague. Somewhere in the late 80s, early 90s, starting to pick up on XAFs and Zanes, which I also taught myself. So virtually everything I know about catalysis I've taught myself by working with graduate students and postdocs here. And then the final element in my toolkit has been the application of theory, starting with quantum theory and then going on to statistical mechanics. And this we started to do in the mid-80s and have continued to the present day. So today we have an ensemble of tools that span everything from experimental, all forms of experimental techniques to theory at its cutting edge. And I enjoy today collaborations with Martin Head Gordon in our chemistry department, both developing and applying advanced methods of quantum chemistry, in collaboration with Don Tilley in chemistry on synthesizing molecular precursors and using them to make catalysts, and making catalysts in particular that have single sites that are easy to characterize and identify and do both experiments and theory. So, in short, this is a trajectory from start to the present, how I got involved in catalysis, what has motivated me, and where I am today. I'd like to say that it's been a fascinating journey. I've had the privilege to work with roughly 140 graduate students, some 60-plus postdocs, with the younger and older colleagues here in both our own department and chemistry, and now increasingly with friends who are in other parts of the U.S. and other parts of the world, and it's a great ride. It's great fun, and it continues to be so. And I'm as excited today as I was in '67 when I came here.
Why did you come to Berkeley?
That's a story in its own right. I had an opportunity in 1966 to drive out here and visit the West Coast. So I drove cross country for the grand total expense of $50. That included gas, camping fees, and occasional groceries. So I drove out here with a French graduate student and shared the driving. And we camped along the way. It took us 5 days to get from Boston to Berkeley. And once here, I realized that there was a very fine university at Berkeley. I knew nothing about Berkeley when I came out here. And I came down, introduced myself to the administrative assistant, and literally told her that I wanted to talk to faculty about either a postdoctoral position or maybe about a faculty position. And so with this very informal self-introduction to Berkeley, I was very graciously greeted here by the chair of the time, Don Hansen, who took me around, introduced me to faculty. This was on a Friday afternoon. Told me to come back Saturday morning because many people work here Saturday. Continued the visit. But nothing formal came out of that visit. And 6 months later, when I was back in Cambridge, I got a phone call from Charles Tobias, the new chair, who literally said, young man, were you fooling around when you came out here and told us that you were looking for a faculty position, or were you serious? And by then I had decided to seriously look for faculty positions, and I'd begun interviewing at Michigan and Caltech and other places. And I said, yes, I'm serious. So he invited me out to Berkeley. Actually, Chevron paid for the trip because I was also interviewing at Chevron in Richmond, and they had a facility at that time in La Habra near Los Angeles, and spent a day at each Chevron facility, 2 days here. And much to my amazement, this trip ended with job offers from both facilities in Chevron and a job offer from Berkeley. So I gave it something like 15 seconds thought, and I said, I'm taking the job at Berkeley. And so again, it was good fortune, good timing, hitting it off with people that led to my being here.
And what has been most satisfying in research?
being here?
Yeah. Thing you're most proud of?
That... I'm most proud of the fact that I've been able to both master and apply a variety of spectroscopic techniques, isotopic tracer techniques, transient response techniques on the experimental side, and now theory, and bring these together on various problems and synthesize this so that now we have an ability to describe catalytic events all the way from being very precise about what we mean when we say an active center to stating what the reaction mechanism is, but from both an experimental and a theoretical standpoint, and showing that the inferences and conclusions that we draw from experiment can be verified by ab initio context-free theory. And I stress context-free, which means that it's theory that was not designed to answer the problem.
And who have you looked up to as mentors through the career?
So some of the key people would be Jack Lunsford at Texas A&M, Michelle Boudard, Keith Hall. I've known all of them over the long span of their careers. I'd say these in the U.S. have been my main, the people who I've respected and learned from and interacted with.
And how have you renewed contact with Russia or?
So I first went to Russia in 1974 with Val Hansel and Joe Hightower from Rice. Val was with UOP at the time as a vice president. And this was under the Soviet-American collaboration of catalysis. And over the next 5 years, we traveled every other year to Russia, or the Soviet Union at the time, and hosted conferences here in the U.S. So we had a series of very intense interactions at that period, until 79. I had three postdocs from Novosibirsk during that period. We had all our discussions in both languages, in English and Russian. As a result, I learned technical Russian from them, the language of chemistry, and they learned better English from me. I formed a lot of friendships in the Soviet Union during this period. Unfortunately, during the next 10-year period, till about the late 80s, there was very little opportunity to travel. But somewhere around 87, I think it was exactly 87, things loosened up again, and I went back to the Soviet Union and to Novosibirsk and to Moscow. And then in that period, Zamarayev and I, he is the director of the Boreskov Institute at the time, decided to hold a Soviet-American meeting on catalysis, which DuPont hosted in Wilmington. And after that, I started traveling on a more regular basis every 2 or 3 years. About 10 years ago, I met my wife, second wife, Tatiana, there, and I was fortunate to have her come over 6 years ago and join me here. So now we go back and forth practically every year.
And how has this interaction benefited you?
How has it benefited me? professionally, it's benefited me by maintaining contact with people over there. They're very fine researchers, both in Moscow and in Novosibirsk, whom I've now known over 30 years. I've had a small but very high-quality group of postdocs come from Russia. I have two with me right now, one of whom is from the Boreskov Institute. The other one is from St. Petersburg and got his doctoral degree here in the U.S. and is now postdocing with me. And I continue to learn from the people in Russia to maintain personal friendships and to interact freely with young people there. I should also add that when I go there, all my discussions and lectures are in Russian.
And how would you contrast the research style, et cetera, U.S. and Russia?
Well, there are strong similarities in terms of objectives and directions. The capabilities and facilities in Russia, even today, are more limited than they are in the U.S. Access to supercomputers is more limited. So people are constrained by capabilities and instrumentation more than they are by ideas or knowledge. I find Russian scientists to be extremely well-read, knowledgeable about the literature, clever in their thinking. And so when given the proper tools, they perform much the same way we do.
Why did your father come to the U.S. From Russia?
That's an interesting story, too. His father, my grandfather, was an entrepreneur in Tbilisi, Georgia. He had started a large-scale plumbing contracting business. He was also an inventor and a businessman. He built one of the first ammonia refrigerators and had it running in his home. He invested in railroads. And the next investment he wanted to make was in sunflower fields in Iran. And the idea was that he was going to send my father, his youngest son, to the States to learn technology, come back, and they would go into a joint operation of harvesting sunflower seeds and producing sunflower oil, which is was then and still is a staple in Russian diet, used for cooking and salads, etc. So that's how my father came over here in 1920 and started to study chemical engineering at MIT. I still have his registration card at home from that period and some other documents of his stay at MIT. And unfortunately, the Civil War progressed down to that part of Russia in the early 20s, and his father had to give up his business and escape, and so the source of money to support him dried up.
And how did you learn Russian language? At home?
At home. Both my parents were Russian. My mother was emigrated from Moscow to first to Paris and then later to New York, where she met my father. My mother was a ballet dancer and did this professionally as a young woman, and then had a ballet school well into her 70s and taught in New York. So we had a very rich and diverse community of friends, mostly Russian-speaking, in the home. And it was my mother's desire to have me have a common language with her parents, who were still in Paris. So she taught me Russian before I could defend myself.
And did you learn writing as well as...
I learned to write and to read from her, yeah.
And what's been your most frustrating experience in research?
Oh, frustrating? Well, I'd say the most frustrating are the times when you're when you work on a problem and you come to a dead end because you realize that the tools and techniques available cannot provide the answer to a problem. And the skill that one develops in carrying on research and guiding research is to recognize as soon as possible that you've come to a wall, that you can't blast through the wall, and that you have to walk around it. And I have told graduate students that this happens explicitly when they start with me, so they should know that this might occur, and that if it were to occur, I'm not going to abandon them. I'm going to help guide them around the wall. We'll redirect and refocus the research towards things that we can do.
Now, how do you get graduate students?
Well, graduate students come to the department. They're recruited to the department as a whole, not by individual faculty members. And then we recruit them from the pool who have been accepted. So this year we have 22 PhD students who have come. I've already talked to a third of them. I'm hoping to get two or three new ones. I've talked to several who I think might join the group two or three times. I encourage them to come and attend my group meeting to talk with my group members and get a sense of what it's like to work with me.
And where do you see your research direction going in the future?
So one of the new areas for me is to look at chemical catalysis applied to biomass conversion. So we've been fortunate to get support from the Energy Biosciences Institute, funded by BP, to look at how one can take apart, deconstruct, it's called, biomass to sugars, and convert sugars to various components that could be either blended into gasoline or diesel fuel, or ultimately become the principal component of these two fuels. So this is one direction. Another direction is looking at what is called hydrogen management in the refinery. This is a program that we've started with Chevron's support. A third area is looking at producing hydrogen from non-carbon sources, principally water, by electrolysis, and addressing the question of why are existing catalysts not more efficient? It turns out that not much is known about the surface chemistry of electrocatalysts. And so Richard Matthies in the chemistry department, a faculty member in the chemistry department, in fact our new dean also, and I have teamed up to apply advanced types of Raman spectroscopy to look at the surface of electrocatalysts. So these are three new areas. And then I'm continuing the development and application of quantum chemical techniques in collaboration with Martin Head Gordon. And this is going along very, very successfully, and we are now, in many instances, able to get results that are in quantitative chemical agreement, quantitative agreement with what we measure experimentally. So it's very satisfying to be able to go into new areas, to use my background and knowledge in other areas, and combine theory with experiments.
Now, how did you make the connection with BP that got the funding here at Berkeley?
So we have two sources of funding with BP. The first, the oldest one, started in 1999 when BP came around to five universities that they had targeted and asked them to compete for a program in methane conversion. So we were fortunate. They decided at the end to not choose one of the five, but actually two of the five, and split the grant. So we ended up with a grant, and so did Caltech. Homogeneous catalysis being done at Caltech, heterogeneous being done here. And the other members of the team are Enrique Iglesias, and at the time, Arup Chakraborty and myself. There were three members here at Berkeley. Arup has since left to go to MIT. And we have asked Martin Head Gordon to join us instead. So it continues to be the three. So we had, starting in January of 2001, funding for 10 years to run this program. And this has been a very successful collaboration with BP and is ongoing. And we're now discussing continuation after 2010 for another 5 years. So we've just finished a proposal to this effect. We hope it's funded. The second line of funding is through the Energy Biosciences Institute, which is a much larger enterprise. Here there are a total of 50 principal investigators, 30 at Berkeley, 20 at the University of Illinois. The Illinois people are doing all what we call agricultural chemistry and science. Berkeley faculty are doing research on biological means of converting biomass to fuels, principally ethanol and butanol. And we and I'd say another three or four investigators, a smaller group, are looking at chemical approaches by chemical catalysis. And so the jury is out as to who's going to have the lead in the end, but we feel very strongly that for the scale of operation that you need to make fuels at a significant level, chemical catalysis in principle ought to win out.
Now, have you gotten involved administratively?
Yes, I've spent nearly half my career doing administrative work here at Berkeley. First as an assistant dean here in the college, then from 81 to 91 as chair of this department, which was a very exciting period because the founders of the department were one by one starting to retire during this period. So I had an opportunity to hire many people. In fact, roughly half of the current faculty are people that I hired during that period. Then I took a brief hiatus, and from 94 to 99, I was dean of the College of Chemistry, which was an exciting experience because we had, not unlike today, budgetary constraints for the first 3 of the 5 years. We were also building a new building, which I inherited as literally a hole in the ground and had to shepherd up a $60 million enterprise and finish fundraising for it. And then commission the building involving getting it ready for 13 new research groups and getting the groups installed. So this was a very satisfying period. We also hired a lot of good people in both chemistry and chemical engineering. Then again, there was a hiatus from 99 till 95, and in 95 through 96, half of 95 and all of 96, I was again department chair. This is after Arup Chakraborty, the chair of the time, decided to go to MIT. So I took over from him until our present chair, Jeff Reimer, stepped in.
How can you keep research going when you're involved in administrative work?
Well, the simple answer is with a lot of effort. I reduced my research group size somewhat, and it dropped to 12 people. But I spent roughly half of every day as a professor and half as an administrator, and I kept the two halves apart, or at least I tried to as much as possible. But I have to say, honestly, that it takes considerable stress and strain to keep the research going. And I also realized that if I stayed in administration too long, I would never be able to get back up to speed after I stopped one of these periods of administrative work.
What do you think has allowed Berkeley to maintain its stature in the research world?
I think the key thing is that we hire people after very careful screening. We hire the very best people that we can find. We try to give them everything necessary so that they can succeed. We are very careful about whom we retain. And in the meantime, while people are here and after they've received tenure, we cultivate a sense of community and a sense that we're working together to build a very fine institution. Many people have said across the disciplines here at Berkeley that the spirit of community and interest in the institution is much higher than it is at other universities. So I think this helps us, particularly in times like the present when we have fiscal constraints. The other thing that makes this a fine institution is that it is very good across the board. So it's easy to find people in other departments to talk to who will share research interests, who are confident enough in themselves to build collaborations. And collaborations have allowed me and others to do work that we would never have dreamt of. I would never have gone into theoretical work had I not been able to collaborate with people.
And do you interact with Lawrence Livermore, or is that pretty?
Yes, I've had a position at the Lawrence Livermore Lab since 1975 as a senior faculty scientist. And roughly half of my funding, all my DOE funding, comes from through the lab. So I continue that relationship, and I have new programs with them, and I'm about to put together a team to apply for yet another program.
What research is the highlight that you've done? Would you pick out as the single?
Oh, that's a hard question. I'd say that it's some of the very recent work that we have done on what I would call single site catalysts. So these are isolated cations or metal oxo groups that are supported on an oxime, where we've been able to use a multiplicity of techniques to characterize them very precisely, confirm our cartoon or picture of a site by using first principles theory, so we have consistency between theory and experiment. Then be able to carry out a reaction on these sites, measure their kinetics, make deductions about the mechanism through various tracer techniques and transient response techniques, assemble all of this, and then validate it again from first principles theory. So it's the idea of bringing ab initio theory together with high quality experimental methods to confirm that in fact the notion or the description that we have at the end is self-consistent.
Now, the U.S. used to be the apex of catalysis research. How do you see it today?
Well, I see it the same way that a NRC study group did recently, reported on it, is that we're still at the head of the pack, but the difference between us and the next group is smaller and declining. And I'd say the other very good groups are in Europe, scattered in Europe. There are good young people coming along who are doing exciting work, who will be there in the next decades. The capabilities, theoretical and experimental in Europe, are as good as they are in the U.S. And there seems to be, I'd say, in general, somewhat more excitement and, if not level of funding, at least willingness to fund in Europe than there is in the U.S. This is from the federal sources, although my European friends tell me they too have trouble getting money, as we do we, so we commiserate with each other.
Well, let's say 1950, it seemed industry had a lot of top-level catalysis people, which
correct.
Seems to have disappeared. Is that just because they hide, or have they disappeared?
No, they have actually disappeared. They've either left to go to universities, or they have retired as they got older. And as I told many of my friends in industry, whom I've admired and respected, that my heroes have disappeared, and I don't see new heroes whom I can respect in a similar way. And the reason is that industry, over now several decades, has constrained its corporate research efforts and focused them on the needs of the business. This is all understandable, but in some ways unfortunate, because it means that industry itself is not doing anything to sharpen the focus on the principal areas of science that need to be refined. What is happening instead is that industry is coming to the universities, often to Berkeley, to partner with us. And so we do the basic science on areas of application which are relevant to their needs. So we've done this with BP very successfully. We're doing it with Chevron. There's a program I'm not involved in, but it's funded by Dow on sustainable chemistry here. We are discussing similar possibilities with other companies. So companies are coming to us now to see if we might partner with them.
Now, do the companies come because they see it as being cheaper, or?
I think they come first because they see we have excellence here. We have excellent people, very capable people, both in chemistry and in chemical engineering. They see a concentration of skills and overlap of skills, which is unique. They know the high reputation. They also know that we produce good students who then mostly seek industrial employment, so this would be a source of people to recruit into their companies. And they now realize that it's possible and easy to work with Berkeley.
And so you think this will continue to grow?
I think at the moment it will continue to grow. And I think even in the negative economic climate that we have right now, it will continue to grow because circumstances in industry aren't going to change, to go back to what you've described in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s.
What can the U.S. do to move up, regain the superior leadership position?
Well, I think the key thing is that we have to make the field of catalysis a national priority. You probably know that Doug Gray from PNNL, Pacific Northwest Laboratories, Bruce Gates from UC Davis and I led a team of folks. We held a workshop in Washington 2 summers ago now, and then wrote a report for the DOE, for the Basic Energy Sciences Division. It's called Research Needs Energy for Catalysis, in which we identified where are the exciting research opportunities and challenge, what are the challenges for taking catalysis further into the 21st century. And we feel that if there were a massive influx of funding for this kind of activity from the federal sources, that this would stimulate young people to go into the field. And the current level of funding is something like $75 million a year from all federal sources, chemistry and chemical engineering integrated. We feel that the level of funding needs to be an order of magnitude higher than that if we're to make a significant dent in the work that's to be done.
Now, Emmett off and on tried to establish a national laboratory for
right.
catalysis. It never succeeded. Do you think there's...
There have been many efforts since Paul's ventures into this. I've tried that too. The reading we got most recently from the DOE was, don't go there. This is not the politically correct or desirable thing to do, because it creates political tension amongst those who don't get to be at the location. And the preferred route is to have large national collaborations involving people in different parts of the country under one program, but not a formal institute. There's also some concern, I think legitimate, that institutes get founded and funded, but don't necessarily succeed and do the best science, because once the founding fathers and mothers leave the scene, the successors may not have the same drive and vision that the founders did. And you can point to examples around the world. So there is some logic for saying one should retain the flexibility of funding people in different places and funding the best people.
Now, on the S-curve, do you see a petroleum industry being at the top of the S? Or?
Well, the petroleum industry is near the top of the S, but that's assuming that petroleum is your feedstock. Petroleum is not a constant feedstock. It's getting heavier and heavier, dirtier and dirtier as we go on through the years. One is having to use shale oil and tar sands. Eventually, coal will be used as a feedstock with its problems associated, so principally the extra CO2 that you have to then dispose of. Methane has been looked at as a feedstock. It's principally of use for the chemical industry, less so for the petroleum industry, other than as a source of hydrogen. I think the real challenges are how to use biomass creatively for both the chemical industry and for the fuels industries of the future. But that is a subject that will take several decades to evolve, not a few years. But it's fun to be at the beginning of that S curve, because you're at the light-off point rather than at the turndown point.
If you could do it all over again, would you still pick catalysis?
Yes, I would, now that I know that by working in the field of catalysis, you can be involved in virtually every aspect of chemistry, all the way from analytical chemistry to physical chemistry, and in between organic and inorganic. And even theoretical chemistry now gets integrated. And then you continue on to the areas of transport phenomena and chemical engineering and reactor design. And we can now see how you can blend these various elements into a smooth and cohesive picture.
Well, Dick Gonzalez says the problem is we're all getting old. What can we do to interest young people?
I think yes, we individually get old, but that doesn't mean that we have to get old in our thinking. That's the first thing. I think as we individuals age, the critical thing is that we not stagnate in our perspective, that we be able to envision a future that's different from the past. We be able to identify challenges, intellectual challenges and technological challenges and research opportunities that are new and significantly different from what we've worked on in the past, that we have the courage of our convictions and our vision to move forward, even though it's always hard and it doesn't get easier as you get older, and that we, the older generation, inspire our younger colleagues, and in particular our graduate students, to recognize that the exciting problems are ahead, and they're always ahead. The field of science is really unbounded. I doubt that we will reach the period and age where we say everything that needs to be known is known. We just have to implement it now.
Any other area you want to add?
No, I want to say that having had the good fortune of being in the academic sector is very exciting, because while I get older, the people I work with stay the same age, average age. And each year I have a few new co-workers, graduate students, and postdocs who are well-educated, excited about what they do, and it's great fun to be a senior collaborator with these very fine young people. And I look forward to doing this for as long as I can do it.
Well,
might be a good place to stop.